Today's summit is the launch of a beautiful collaboration between BLOXHUB and the Innovation Center Denmark. BLOXHUB was founded in 2018 as an initiative to create a space where collaboration and partnerships between companies, organizations, and researchers and practitioners can emerge. We're about 700 research institutions, organizations, and companies who share our lives in BLOXHUB, either as residents or as members. The thriving community can be seen in new research projects, networks forming, partnerships emerging, and new product development. We believe the new solutions to sustainable urban development come from consilience and collaborations. And Camilla, welcome. We have been working for so long for today.
Yes.
And we've promised that we would be here together, excited and delighted, as we say in Ireland. And now I'm going to let you welcome.
Thank you so much. And thank you so much to BLOXHUB for arranging this event in collaboration with the Innovation Center of Denmark. Just in short, to give you a brief introduction to the Innovation Center of Denmark, I just want to mention that we are a bilateral organization between the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and the Ministry of Higher Education. We have 7 centers around the world in Bangalore, in Seoul, in Shanghai, in Tel Aviv, in Munich, in Silicon Valley, and in Boston. The whole purpose of the Innovation Center of Denmark is to elevate Danish science, industry, and government body collaborations at these global hotspots, and hopefully meet up with partners and stakeholders in the 7 different ecosystems in order to collaborate on topics like reinventing cities and green transition. So thank you so much for arranging this event for us.
It's our pleasure. And I hope that you will all agree in a few hours that this collaboration is unique and strong, because the whole purpose and objective of today is exactly to create partnerships between us around the world by combining our networks, our strength, through summits like this. I have some practical information. As you know, we are transmitting and you are participating through Zoom. There will be some breakout sessions later today. And if you, in your Zoom menu, can click on participant, then press on your name. If you rename yourselves with the name you've registered by, we will make sure that you end up in the right breakout session. Some of you have creative Zoom names, and that is lovely. But for the purposes of today and the summit of creating collaboration and partnerships, it would be wonderful if you rename yourselves. So thank you very much for that. I also have, as you may have noticed, a wonderful collaborator and colleague, namely Ida Nielsen, Head of Section and Communications Manager. And Ida is our chat hostess. You will meet a lot more of our BLOXHUB colleagues and innovation colleagues in the breakout sessions today. If you have any questions about Zoom, we also have a great team of technicians and producers who are able to answer you in the chat. So feel free to pose any questions and comments if something is bugging you a little bit. Just to go through the program, we have an exciting day ahead of us, or half a day anyway. We have Signe Kongebro that I will call upon in just a few seconds as our keynote speaker. And Signe is Global Design Director, Urbanism and Landscape Partner at Henning Larsen Architects, and was awarded a prestigious award for her dedication to sustainable architecture and urban development by Nykredit only last week. And when I saw that announcement, I thought, how pertinent, not only well-deserved, but also how just relevant that award was for today, because it kind of illustrates just how capable and capable hands you are to be presented of visions and ambitions of how to transition our cities to the green urbanism that we're trying to do. Then we have a debate, and with me for the debate, I have another 2 brilliant people, Nikolaj Sveistrup and Ditte, Lysgaard, she will be with us also. And then you'll go into your breakout sessions where you have a BLOXHUB facilitator and an Innovation Center colleague as well. Then we'll be returning in for an open debate at 11. And at 12 o'clock Danish time, we will bid adieu and welcome you to our next summit. So that is the program for today. And I hope you are as excited as I am for this day that is ahead of us. So without further ado, Camilla and I will now leave the scene and welcome Signe Kongebro. Thank you. Welcome, Signe.
Yes. Thank you for inviting me for this super exciting title of today's event. My name is Signe Kongebro. I'm a head of urbanism and landscape in Henning Larsen, and I'm a global design director and partner. I will go through some overall projects, sort of framing the issues we're dealing with here. And then I will show some cases on how we are working with R&D. And what are the right priorities for our business? I think we ask us these questions every day, and I think it's a huge importance that we do that. Is it about improving urbanization? Is it about tackling mobility? Or is it about preparing for extreme weather events? Or taking on the next global crisis? I would say that we need to be dealing with all of them. And from my chair, I would say that it is sort of urbanism that frames both architecture, landscape, and planning. And it's all about the questions we ask and the impact we create. And we use urbanism and architecture and landscape as a filter to generate these green transformations. Because it is in urbanism that we dream of what society we can become. Because doing urbanism, producing urbanism, is about partnerships, collaborations, and is always about the future. I think that is also very important, and that's also why it is, a multidisciplinary tool. The decarbonized future starts in unleashing the hidden contextual potentials. And with that, we mean that it is both sort of the hardware existing on site, but it's also about the cultural heritage and the value for society that can actually be sort of unleashed in the design we do. And of course, we decarbonize through the design solutions we do. This image is from Aarhus Rewater. It's a wastewater plant in Aarhus, actually bringing sort of the backside of society infrastructurally to the front stage of Aarhus. Actually having this project becoming as important as Mosgaard or the big museums and so on, because it will be part of a big destination for the Aarhus. I would say when working in urbanism, it has a lot of links into, of course, the small scale. And I will try to demonstrate a little how it works together. We also talk about reducing, reusing, and recycle. There's a lot of course, hygiene in these terms, but I think I will talk upon them on the way that I combine it with projects. I will start talking about reducing through timber, reducing carbon dioxide through use of timber, and here we're doing a city in Copenhagen, a completely new city. I will zoom out as we go through the slides, and it is about how to create urban living and actually create the rural feeling of community. So we created this new typology, sort of an open block, a U-shaped block, where it lowers towards the lakes. And it looks like this, if you imagine this inhabit with trees and people and different types of architecture. And with this typology, you can create a village. where you have the center in the middle, the meeting place, and then it will become more and more private as we go. And actually using this village as an urban typology to create the whole new destination and district in Fil.Dr. So we put them out in three different clusters and combining them with a new mobility strategy where it's a ring road where you can go only very slowly around, and you will have access to nature even more close to the center of where you live. And this is how the plan looks. It's a very open-ended design. It's not a fixed design in that sense that you can change it over time. And what we have done here is that we have worked with this in a parametric way. We have researched for 10 years, I think, in the how we should be working with computational design, and actually measuring while designing, measuring on important stuff relevant for this project. And what has been important here is that it is open-ended because things are changing, legislation are changing. So how can we keep a design for a new city significant and distinct and still have it in a collaborative way where we onboard new types of knowledge as we develop? And in this case, four parameters, design parameters, was relevant. It was about density and square meters, placement of that in the upper left corner. Right below, it is about having view to nature, create as much, as many flats that has view to nature around Fil.Dr. And then in the upper right corner, you see access to daylight. Daylight is a free resource and it's a human right to have access to this, and creating facades where you can have more daylight on the facades, then it's up to the architects to create the right holes to suck that daylight in, I would say. But in the master plan, it's about creating the surfaces right. And lastly, we have wind. It's a windy place. And how can we shield from the wind and create a microclimate that is sort of prolonging the good seasons, creating outdoor areas where it's possible to create more community outside the buildings. And this is one of the images looking from inside. Reuse of existing buildings. This is a project, it's a international and partnership funded by a lot of sponsors in Denmark. It's called Rebus, and it's about using the existing building stock as a backdrop for creating a decarbonized way of renovation. 60 to 80% of the building's CO2 is bound sort of in the structure of a building. And how can we reuse that as much as possible without tearing it down and building up new? This is a building block, it's called Ballerup-blocken, and we have approximately 12 million square meters of this typology in Denmark. Think about how it looks in Europe. So the Green Deal becomes very relevant for this type of buildings. We created a new facade that can be hanged on the existing facade while you're going shopping in the local supermarket. So it's about people living in their homes, not necessarily needs to live somewhere else while we renovate the buildings. And this way of actually hanging the new facade on was part of the prototyping of this Rebus partnerships. We did a lot of other stuff, but I think this facade also demonstrates how prefabrication and the way of doing renovations will transform in the future. And this is our commitment to this agenda. So it's about creating better living conditions, and this image shows it all. I think it's very simple in a way, before and after. More daylight in the buildings, more livability using a facade, you will have better indoor climate, and so on and so on. And it is very easy to mount as you see in this image, people are still living there, and you just mount it on a lift like we do with the terraces and balconies today. And this is an image of the transformation. And lastly, I would like to talk about recycle through transformation of existing industrial square meters, brownfields as we call them. This is in Gdansk. So we have a lot of structures, especially in Europe, where we have existing infrastructure, existing buildings, existing everything that needs to have a repurpose. We need to look upon this as a resource, and we want to create sort of also a link, cultural link to history by using the existing bound culture and bound carbon in all of this. So we have this situation all over Europe, I would say. So can we work with sort of reinventing a new identity for these areas? I think it's very important that we use all kind of creative placemaking to make this happen while we design and while we build. So it's also about embracing the history. And in this specific case, we're also working with the cultural ministry of Poland, because it is important. This is also where the Cold War sort of ended, by having Lech Walesa and all the political movement in this area. So how can we do this? And of course, we came up with thousands of ideas to how tough should we be on the existing structures. And I will not go through all the details, but I'm just saying that on our side, unleashing contextual potentials is not only about the resources bound in the hardware, but also, of course, about cultural assessment and how we unfold history. These are images where you see the mixture and also the variations of this. And of course, the overall dream could be if you could swim here. But that takes also a lot of effort, like in Copenhagen, where it took a lot of political power to wanted to clean up the city. I'll just go through a couple of projects that we did on the R&D. I think these R&D projects are sort of prototyping, and they will emerge in projects at a later stage in 5-10 years time, but we are practicing. So we do a lot of projects, we do a lot of design method, and we do a lot of research. So for us in Henning Larsen, there is a link between state-of-the-art knowledge and research, using that, creating design methods and thought leaderships in this field, and of course embed some of this in our projects. We have a lot of in-house industrial PhDs, and I will just go through two of them. This is Finua, he's a Christian. He has been working as a PhD, especially on the Uppsala City Hall. This is an idea for City Hall where we want to have the public coming in. This should be an indoor plaza. So in a way, it is a new type of mixture in the urban setting where it's not sort of the indoor-outdoor situation, but you will have a fluid ground floor in this type of building. And we see that all over the world. So how can you control the acoustic here in a way where you don't make it like a museum, but it is a lively place, and still having people working on very close to without being annoyed. So we did a lot of study on this, and we invented a new type of software. So it came from, and we were inspired by how we do CFD simulation on waves instead of radiation. So, and then we used the virtual reality combined, so we could actually create this software where it was a 1,000 times faster than in the old way of simulation. So we could do it on time. And of course, Fino was very eager to work with this because he's also a rock musician. So for him, sound, noise is part of the same universe. So soundscapes are important for architecture. And of course, there's a lot of stuff going on behind. But for us, this type of project is very relevant for how we do urban design. How can we make cities where there's low emission, but also it's more livable in terms of noise? Another project is about materials. How can we be working with new types of materials, actually combining the knowledge from Pelle, PhD in the office, working with this hierarchy of good materials in terms of CO2. And if you see on the lower part here, you will also see, yeah, it's about how you become what you eat and so on, so it's something we know. We actually take a straw. And how can we work with this in a new type of building? So we worked on this more as a prototype development, creating this school in Jutland, where sort of all the surfaces become a part of the learning facility for the students. We're also working with other types of modeling. We have this sandbox, and this is how we develop, while we design, we develop the terrain, we develop sort of the urban setting with heights, and then you can see on the screen that at the same time you will have the Rhino model produced while we are designing. And I think there's something about working simultaneously with knowledge and data, new design processes, together with the creative intuition. And lastly, I would talk a little about partnerships in terms of sort of real clients. We have one of the biggest pension funds in Denmark. We are designing this area outside in the North Harbour in Copenhagen. And what we have tried here is saying, okay, we have a billion dollar investment here, and how can we use innovation at the same time? Can we develop something while designing? And we have in Copenhagen a politic on nature-based design related to urban development. And there is something about, of course, all the trees that we are having, and how can we be working with this while designing? So we applied for, got some funding from Eco Innovation in the Environmental Ministry to develop a new green facade. The green facades you see today are sort of where the green is put on, and we wanted to create sort of a new facade, sort of where you could take away the traditional and actually apply this facade right into the detailed design while designing. And as you see on the left, on the right side, you can see that it takes a lot of partners to participate in this, both decision making, the risk assessment, but also in the overall design solution. And I think for us, it is part of the vocabulary of what we are doing. And this is a screenshot from our website. And feel free to go in and look at this, because all these journeys on creating research and development relating to the upscale projects is sort of crucial for us in Henning Larsen. But it all begins with curiosity. And this will be my end slide. And I hope that you have understood a little about how we work, but please come forward if you have any questions. Thank you.
I'm gonna join you entering the talking before I'm in the scope, and apologies. But thank you, Signe. This was absolutely fascinating. Really, 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 really brilliant. A few questions maybe from the chat, but while I'll see, I'm looking into the room, I have a few questions. Yes. Because I think you touched upon it here at the end with it begins with curiosity. And I had the pleasure of interviewing you about a little over a year ago, where we tapped into that kind of core of Henning Larsen in terms of the research and development, to also how you practice. Can you elaborate, because that hasn't just been done in a day. Like, we heard a little bit about two of the research projects, but it's taking a bit of time, right?
Yes, yes, it did. And I think one of the things that we how we worked in the beginning was that we said, okay, let's take these researchers, people working with R&D, and merge them in a project, and then just do innovation. And we found out that that was not possible because of the way of thinking, the way the pace, everything differs a lot.
Yeah.
So we created sort of a cluster within the office where you would have the possibility of studying or doing research in a slower pace, because it's it is about understanding also the deep fundamentals, and it and that's why we wanted to shield them a little, and now we also help if someone in the office come say I have this brilliant idea, I want to study new mobilities, how new mobility influence urban design, and then we help getting the funding, writing the application, setting up partnerships, so that person can be focusing on this. And then later on, that person will also be sort of the thought leader within the office on this topic. So it's also about, you know, finding the ideas that is already there. It doesn't have to be that shielded, this environment, but of course, while producing it, you need to have some kind of space.
And I think one of the wonderful things about your presentation is also how you address that this is a manifold topic. Like, we can talk about recycling, we can talk about reducing, and we can talk about the urban development in terms of the social aspects. And all of these various aspects are codependent, interrelated, and yet so complicated in their own right. What would, because also in one of our talks you also said this takes time to build. So initially that you basically launched a research project where you needed new knowledge inside your own office, your own company. And then you started looking into knowledge that could benefit the entire industry. That is also a journey, I would expect.
Yeah, I think we came to a conclusion very early when we started that we need to share. We need to be a lot of people in this. And I mean, protecting your own knowledge doesn't create any impact at all. So it was easy for us to collaborate. I think it's also part of the Henning Larsen sort of culture, that partnerships and knowledge in this way needs to be shared, needs to be sort of redeveloped by others and then coming back.
Because I think when you touched upon Rebus, which, just as you said, there were so many partners involved in that. There were a lot of the business model of that project was also kind of with a lot of various sponsors. And how do you then engage once you identify something that you want to collaborate on? What would your advice be to forming these partnerships?
I think when we look for potential projects or we are looking for impact, what could be relevant for the future. And then we use our intuition. I think I will have a gut feeling about bio-based materials. So I know there is something there, but then we have to find out what are the, where's the professional friction in this. And then we start sort of unfolding it as onion rings and understanding what are the combinations and what are the possibilities here. And if we find sort of a blind spot where we can see that we can participate in actually linking things that is not linked today, I think this is also where we want to be placed. So it's more a blue ocean situation in the research field. And I think that is also how it become international, because suddenly you will be linked to MIT, you'll be linked to Shanghai, to all kind of different partners that has seen these blind spots in
You literally read my mind, because I was going to actually ask you whether this would also apply internationally, because I know that you are active internationally. So I was so wonderful. I'm glad that you touched upon that.
But maybe I can add.
Yes.
It's not only a closed loop. It is also about finding the right clients.
Yeah.
So the clients are very important here. It's not just innovation for innovation's sake. It is finding the global partners that has this ambition.
Yeah.
And what we see right now internationally is that You know, they are really appearing. It's both the car industry, the automotive industry, but also all the developers and of course the global cities. So you will see this link between them, that they know they have a they need to interact. And of course, if we can support and facilitate this applying knowledge in the right way, I think this is where our dream position.
Yeah, so that's fascinating. So you have the different industries. They're all more or less beginning to be very interested in this green transition, this sustainable urbanism that we need to create in order to make sure that we reduce our carbon emissions and do not exploit our planet, the planetary boundaries, etc.
Exactly. It is Shanghai. It is Seattle. It is the fish industry in Norway. It is the automotive in Germany with Volkswagen. It's Volvo in Sweden. I mean, they are all there, and they're very eager to collaborate and see their product as part of a holistic approach, because they know that they are part of supporting, and they know that they wanted to show how they can solve their corner of the green transition.
Yeah, because you also mentioned two things, that identifying that kind of releasing the potentials and also unfold your own history.
Yeah.
So how would you see that internationally? How does that come about?
I think working with cultural heritage, identity, social friction, community engagement, this is sort of the fundamentals in working with urbanism.
Mm.
Because if it's not in use, it has no value for us.
Mm.
I mean, for animals it's different, we'll not go into that now. Mm. But for human beings, a culture is very important.
Mm.
And I think it is, you need to create a sort of multidisciplinary sensibility to understand why something comes from a certain point and how we can sort of unleash this into a new type of society of what we can become.
Mm.
And that takes a lot of skills in onboarding the right people at the right time. It can be NGOs, it can be communities present at a certain spot.
Mm.
It can be cultural and environmental ministries and so on. So it is facilitating all these participants in the right way.
Yeah.
And I would say, and keep an open-ended design, because it can't, even though you need to create visions and beautiful images, you still need to create something that is not static.
Mm. Can you elaborate a little bit? Because sounds enticing.
Yeah, I think one of the things that when we have had success lately, it has been on urbanism in this way of thinking, it has been about that they are choosing us as a partner with the right method, with sort of an ethics, creating a narrative that can onboard all these stakeholders.
Yeah.
So we will not be sort of producing a piece of design, we will more be sort of a hostess of having all these types of knowledge put into play in the right order.
Mm.
And then we help curate while designing, showing different scenarios based on different types of data and values and so on.
Really, really interesting. As you know, I was very, very, I was smitten by Pille's pyramid of materials, because it becomes very tangible and relatable for someone who is not used to working with materials. I was also thinking the taxonomy of materials, whether that pyramid can be applied in any setting, or whether your experience, and here comes my question from an international point of view, if there are a hierarchy of coveted materials internationally that would in some way clash with that pyramid.
I mean, this pyramid has been very important for the discussion nationally, I would say, and there has been a lot of debate on this.
Mm.
So in a way, just producing this And having the discussion of this hierarchy is very important. Mm. Whether this goes up here and this goes down, and internationally, do we have? I mean, we had to find a way to work with this. Yeah. The next thing, and I didn't show this today, is that we are working in the same way with mobility. So making a hierarchy of impact with sort of how can we create a mobility strategy where sustainable mobility is not related to one mode, but is related to sort of the link between modes.
Oh, that's fascinating.
But that's a whole new topic.
Yeah. And that's in one of the breakout sessions, so I'm just assuming that those of you that will be discussing urban mobility, yeah, that's extremely interesting. Then you mentioned another, I love facts, but and you mentioned there are 12 million of square footage in of typology in terms of these. Yes, exactly. And you said, just imagine how many there must be in Europe, let alone the rest of the world. Yeah. And we know that these buildings, these types of construction, are facing either demolition or renovation. And what would your, I heard you say, everyone is saying renovate, renovate, renovate. Mm. But how can we also make sure that we do it in the right way? What would your advice be on that matter?
I would say now we have tools, design tools and production to actually do this. Mm. It's cheaper, it's more efficient, and in a way you also create better homes in this way. Mm. So I think it is about how these settlements of these blocks, do you need to densify? Do you need to do something else between them in order to create communities that has a little more relevance than when we did this back-to-back structures. Yeah. So I think now we have the tools, so now it's just, you know, a discussion with the clients and the municipalities on what kind of neighborhood do you want, what kind of city do you want to be, because you don't have to tear it down.
No.
And I think it's important that we not only look at the sort of the top tier projects all the time, but some of the elements for creating suburban urbanism is also about technological solutions. Mm. And I think now we have it. And you can sort of just order it.
Yeah.
And then it's easy to see the price and so on and so on. And I think for Henning Larsen, it has also been a discussion on how can we sort of creating normally unique design solutions, how can we participate in something where it is about repetition and so on. So I think there's also a lot of things that needs to be teared down in our understanding of the industry, that, you know, things are sliding, and that's fine. Saint-Gobain is also part of this.
Yeah.
They're normally producing materials, but now they're producing facades.
Yes.
So there is new types of partnerships in the industry.
And that is, I think, I hope somebody will let me know if there are questions that we should answer from you guys out there. Otherwise, I have loads of questions, because I think this is quite interesting. We've also touched upon that in terms of the partnerships, that when you collaborate in such a way, then obviously your core will slide. You will be inspired, and you will start engaging in other aspects of the problem solving, if you like. And I think what you just said in terms of what type of city is given today, that we have reinventing our cities. And I remember at a previous stage where we had a wonderful conversation, you also said that it's extremely important to look at the building from the inside, indoor climate and all that. But you said it's just as important to look at the facade of the building and the interaction that building provides to the space in which it's situated. So when we're reinventing cities at a global scale, what would your dream for that city be? Oh.
I think for many years, urbanism was equivalent to planning, seen from above, big highways and so on. I think some of the things that I've been super interested in lately has been working with sort of the hyperlocal and how the hyperlocal with 200 by 200 meters, how that area becomes a home. That it's not only the square meters I own or I rent, but it is the whole sort of entering my neighborhood is also home, and the power and the way we can empower the hyperlocal. And of course, that touches upon governance of could we actually create more variation in identity by setting these communities free as a demo urban areas or something. But where there is an ability to work both with mobility, renovation, rainwater, facades, renovation, and social communities. And I think we do that when we do Fil.Dr, when we start all over from scratch. But how can we work with this in sort of an existing scene?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So in a way, I once drew a drawing of my own home, and I knew exactly, you know, this space is when entering, so this is how it looks, this is my hall, this is my stair to the flat, and so on. That is all part of my space, as I consider it. Of course, shared with others, but it's a spatial understanding of sort of a homey feeling.
Yeah.
Or a place where I belong. Mm. And I think we need to work with this, these more emotional design parameters in working in urbanism.
Yeah, rather than the top-down.
Yeah.
I think I could see, I could feel that. So more emotions, a little bit of, a good bit of curiosity, and collaboration across various disciplines in reinventing our cities. And I think, as we all know, globally, there are many cities that need renovating or reinventing as well, and we'll dive further into that. For now, Signe, thank you so very much. I wish that everyone could clap so you could hear it, but it was a very, very inspiring. Thank you very, very much. Yeah. You are my wingman, as it were, to set off the breakout sessions. And when I wrote to you, you both immediately said, "Absolutely." And I said, "It's going to be one of these. We want to engage and motivate and enthusiasm, if we can say that as a verb." Some enthusiasm for the breakout sessions, because people at this point have already been patient with us. So, you can do it, I know. And first of all, I wrote to you and I said, okay, what would your initial thoughts be on Signe's wonderful presentation, not to influence your answer, but... development, and I'll start with... Even you had troubles with the microphone. It's always nice to test it.
Yeah, sure. It definitely resonated a lot, I think, both in terms of the solutions, but also in particularly the process of how to get there and how we need to be much better at working across silos, not just silos between industries, but silos in between areas of field we're coming from. So the research and being anchored in research, but also very much the projects such as the acoustics, but then relating to sound and music and really having that architecture meets culture meets research meets traditional business. I think we need a lot more of that. But yeah, so definitely resonated a lot.
Yeah. What were your initial thoughts? You sat and
I'm always very happy to listen to Signe, and I think this good holistic approach she always has is a very good, but I do have to say it's not enough. I mean, what we are talking about here is what we have been talking about since the late 80s, and we do have to think upon this. We have to think upon sustainability. So when we talk about in the institute about the future, we have to think of new ways of doing things. We have to make a new thinking, and we are talking a lot about the regenerative society and the regenerative cities, and we want to make all our thinkings going on to way, not how to reduce things or how to make all the bad things we're doing a little bit better, but have to do things good. We have to make a plus society where everything we do now is going to improve what we're doing.
That ties very well into my next question, because we wrote on our website in terms of livable cities. Cities continue to experience population growth, megacities are growing, and as are the big cities as well. So do the challenges. We must ask ourselves, how do we ensure healthy cities which support high quality of life? What do livable cities require? And what do the citizens wish? So when you talk about regenerative cities, is that your vision, or is
it's it even... It's absolutely a wish, and if you look at it, we don't have a lot of solutions that can do that today. So that's also why we call it the moonshot of our time. So we have to make some solutions that actually go beyond, and we don't have so many of them right now.
No.
So everything we do make this CO2 and so on. So we have to change the way we're thinking.
Ditte?
Yeah, I mean, I think absolutely the goal is a regenerative economy, a regenerative society. But as professionals, we need to be mindful of a regenerative society is not opposed to a circular society or a sustainable society. It's all part of a solution leading towards a regenerative society. So I think we have a lot to do also in making sure that rather we work with acoustics, rather we work with the materials, rather we work with community building. If we really want to get to a regenerative, it's not about necessarily leaving them all of those behind, but taking them into one overall solution where they're benefiting each other rather than being in opposites to each other.
I love it, because one of my questions would be exactly not to replace one word with another, and then it's obfuscating what it's all about. Nobody understands. So what is this now? We had sustainable, then we're circular, now we're... So can you unfold, what do you mean by regenerative? What is in that word when we talk about regenerative cities?
Yeah. So I'm of course very much coming from a circular perspective, so that will in some influence my path toward a regenerative society. But it really, there's this wonderful group of researchers out of Cambridge that has this notion of with both eyes open. So what they saw that when we started optimizing and making things more efficient, energy efficient and such, we opened...
So there is, that's the plus that you also mentioned, Nikolaj, if you want to come.
That's the plus. And when we are talking about it, we also look into, because when we are discussing, it's often about the materials and the buildings. And today you can do a lot of different things that we try to reuse and so on, but we also have to think the kind of materials. When Signe, sorry, I'm pointing over there. She's sitting here. When Signe is talking about new materials and so on, it's very important that we do that, but also do the scaling, because what we see here often is that we have one project there and one project there, and we need to do the scaling. But I also have to say that the city is a lot more than the buildings. It's also the people. We have to look into, you're talking about health and the environment, and we're talking about how people are living indoor. But we also have to talk about what is the good city in the future. Yeah. So when we talk about regenerative, it's also about how are people actually moving on and living in such a city. And it's of course important with health, but it's... When we look into the future cities, we're seeing that the cities will have a new purpose. We call it the new urban purpose, because we don't have to shop here. We don't have to work here, because we can do everything digital and on the distance. So what we really need of the city, we still want to live here. So it's going to be the culture, it's going to be the health, it's going to be all the well-being for us.
Yeah, because people actually seek to the cities. I mean, I know that we are still around the world experiencing the pandemic that has been with us throughout 2020. But what we are at large scale observing is actually still an influx to cities. So people seek cities either for jobs or for other aspects, that sense of community, and Signe used the word belonging. So I completely agree with you that part of the reinventing cities is also what kind of cities do we want for the people that live in it. And that's part of the regenerative city, as you, just so when we're kind of sustainable, circular, I want to make sure that we're all on board. What do we mean by it? Mm.
I think there's a lot in the intentions behind. Mm. So when people are seeking towards the cities, are they seeking towards the cities because it's the only place to find a job that can enable them to provide for their family? That's one scenario. Or are they seeking to the cities to, in order to have a community, a connectedness, a place of belonging?
Yeah.
And that's where we need to go if we want to talk about livable regenerative cities.
Yeah.
And so there's a lot in the systems around it, right?
Yeah.
Why do we build cities? Why do we build buildings? Yeah. Do it because we want to have that livable city where people really can thrive?
Mm.
Or do we build buildings and cities because we have to create a certain amount of returns?
Yeah.
And then, you know, afterwards we try to fix things around it.
Yeah, because it's two very different ways into building. Or motives, if you like. That is a distinction that is worth bringing into the discussion. Nikolaj?
Yeah, as you say, it's the system around the city. That's also why we're talking about the systemic change. A lot of people is talking about that. And it's also very hard to get to what exactly the change is going to be. But one of the issues is that all the food we get into the city and get out, or the water, all the supplies, how can we do that in another way? I know some cities really have problems. We don't have these big problems here in Copenhagen, but you know, in Singapore they reuse all the water. They have developed the technologies to do that and so on. So we can actually do some of these things.
Yeah.
Technology and one of the big issues for us is also, is the technology going to save us from all our problems, or do we have to have some other solutions? One of the solutions is of course how to produce our food. I mean, when we talk systems, it's this what get in, what get out, and some of the most important things of how we are challenging the planetary boundaries is how we produce our food and the distance we eat food from all over the world. Do we need to have that, or could we actually farm it just outside the city?
Yeah. So. And I think that taps into to your initial point in terms of the circular aspect, not to lose sight of that when it comes to the regenerative city, that kind of hyperlocal, as Signe also talked about, can we ensure some systemic cycles within and around the cities to, for example, reduce the long transportation distances, etc.
Yeah, and I think what we also need to be mindful of, if we're looking at the scale of the problem today, I like to take the 9 planetary boundaries as a sort of starting point for that, and biodiversity and climate in particular, but you know, more than anything, what we can just rest assured on is that the problem is so ginormous.
Yes.
That,
you know, the opportunity. I could just feel it as you said it.
But that gives opportunity, and that also means that, you know, we don't have to necessarily, it's not going to be a one sort of silver bullet that fixes everything. There is so much opportunity, whether you're working from a technological point of view, a cultural point of view, a systemic point of view. There's a need for your solutions either way, because it's going to be a lot that needs to come together for us to really get there.
Yeah, so when you talk about the new
moonshot, or Mars, or whatever.
Any kind of, so when we talk about reinventing the cities, that moon that we're striving to achieve when we're reinventing the cities, you're saying that we can actually work at it from different angles, but if we're all steering towards the same goal or objective or dream, as Signe kind of talked about, using our emotions, aspiring to a dream, then there is a possibility. And just tapping into I was part of a discussion where you also said we need to talk a lot about consilience. That word, in terms of that we come together from different disciplines, different fields of knowledge, but that we collaborate together in order to create these solutions to a ginormous challenge. Yeah, that is also one of your...
Yeah, we have so much that we need to build upon.
Yeah.
One of the things I spent quite a lot of time on now is writing my second book, which is called Danish Design Heritage and Global Sustainability, with the hope of saying, okay, we actually have a lot of experience, knowledge of creating really good things that can work and thrive and that we can desire, and how do we take all of that knowledge and turn it into the relevance and the scale that it needs to have in our current society, being that there's so much that we can build upon and learn from, rather than thinking that we have to create everything from anew. It's more about setting things together in the right context.
Yeah.
The future.
And that taps into something that you're also saying, Nikolaj, that we actually have part of the knowledge we do have in different pockets of society, but we need to bring them together in our... You wrote about utopia.
And we do have to learn to listen to each other
and to
pick up all the good things. And then, of course, we're going to have some try and error because we have to move fast. If all these IPCC reports, results and recommendations is actually true, we have to move fast.
Yeah.
We just have to go explore all these different ways. And and as normally we said, there's not only one way. We have to go different ways and just... that we have this perspective that everything has to be doing good, then we can do a lot of try and errors, because there will be errors, of course.
Yeah, and I'm going to bring you guys into the next part of what I also wrote to you in terms of this is good, this is aspiration, these are objectives, these are visions and ambitions. And then at the end of the day, we also need to we'll need sustainable business models. And as we are in a global context, the business models currently around cities and city developments vary extremely. I mean, there's such a big difference. What we wrote as part of today was, with an increased focus on securing city climate change, there is also a focus on long-term investments. Who invests in the cities and which business models to use if we are to that benefits
investors, the climate, as well as the people who live and work in the cities. And I think it's to go from the objective and the aspirational stage to say, okay, how can we also take your brilliant suggestions and recommendations and experiences, and how do we then form the partnerships that can finance this transition?
Nikolaj, do you want to go first this time?
One of the big movements right now is in the financial sector, where people are looking into how do we actually spend our money, the pension funds and so on. So my advice is change your investors instead of going what the investors want to do. If you really have this area, you have a city or something, you have to change who do you actually want to invest here, because there's an awful lot of money and a lot of competition about making the best projects right now. So it's just to move on and get the best investors. So that's a change in your perspective.
So I think that there's, my answer will have kind of two levels.
Yeah.
One being, there is a lot of good trends happening. Signe also touched upon it. There's a lot of interest and a lot of demand happening, which is great. There's still too much money to be made short term in doing the wrong thing. And that's a very big challenge in terms of getting there in time.
Yeah.
And also a big challenge in that making sure on a societal level in terms of infrastructure that we don't have too large CapEx investments happening at the moment in the wrong things that we then take too long to have to before they're repaid, essentially.
Yeah.
And then the other thing is just in terms of coming back to an earlier point in terms of it's, you know, all about having returns. It's great and that. But there was a time in which we built our financial systems on them being a service, to rather it was it that you built a building or you built a company. And those have kind of been changed to this opposite. Like now we're building buildings a little bit as a service to the financial sector, etc. And that's something that we need to be very, very mindful of, because my fear would otherwise be that we're trying to do good, but we're essentially just what Badiou would call symbolic violence, and just kind of recreating the same system. So it's just something on that there are several levels in which we need to address this if we really want to create sustainable.
So the impetus for investment has to change.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. That's also why we're discussing what is value in the future.
Yeah.
I mean, we know people are changing. We know you can just see the last 50 years here, how many changes, or 20 years, how many changes there have been. What does it look in 20 or 30 years? Mm. What is the value? What kind of what is the most important thing for people there? Mm. And how do we create a new kind of value issues? I think that's very, very interesting.
I agree. I had Professor Thomas Lützendorf from Karlsruhe Institute of Technology with me last week, and he said that at he can actually identify at macro level that the investment is changing, also the banks, so that when you have people or investors wanting to obtain a huge loan to create a new building, some banks, internationally speaking, are not unless there is a sustainable or a circular model in play based to, you know, as a caveat to that construction that they want to embark on. And I think that there is some sort of transition taking place, which I think is interesting at a global level, if we can identify some large scale movements in terms of accreditation from banks, pension funds. I also know that there is in Belgium, there is a company working with advice pension funds securing sustainable investments. Because it's also, as you have been saying, quite complicated to identify whether this is a sustainable or a circular investment. So now we are experiencing organizations that will help the pension funds
to be sure that where they are investing is actually doing good. Yeah, and I think those type of things is great. We need that transparency, but also just in the sort of systemic partnerships, I'm also very happy to see that the European Union is taking a very large role in creating the new taxonomy and really making sure that when there is so much effort towards going sustainable, we actually know what we're talking about, making sure we're talking about the same things that we can compare and thus have a greater transparency towards what is it actually that we're doing, we're talking about. Yeah. We don't know everything they're going to do yet, but I have quite a lot of hopes for that.
Because I think that is a prerequisite for scale and speed, that there is that
level of transparency, because I talked to you at a few weeks ago where you also said, I don't want any more talk, I want some action. And you have been, you're also one of the pioneers in this field. So what did you mean by that? As we're talking, I'm sorry.
I think I have this feeling of, you know, I call it enlightened action, because we need way more action.
Yeah.
Of course, to act as smartly as possible.
Yeah.
But one of the problems that I very much see is that analysis paralysis, in terms of you're creating these strategies that are based on things that you hope you can make sure is something that you know, but it's actually not something that you know, and it might change before the strategy is over.
Yeah.
So we need to get a lot better at trying and failing and acting and doing and looking at how we operate in a company. Way.
Yeah, so that goes back actually to what Signe said, we need to develop while designing. Yeah. Nikolaj?
Well, I'm always thinking of, we make a lot of decisions every day.
Yeah.
And people are making all these, in my opinion, wrong decisions every day. They're continuing the way that they do today, and the way of thinking.
Mm.
So if you just started thinking every time we have to make a decision, what can we do?
We would be paralyzed.
Yeah. I mean, you can just go and see in all the decisions made in all the rooms today.
Yeah.
If you could change it just for one day, it would change the world.
Yeah.
So the everyday decisions is where we have to do the rethinking. And then, of course, we also think big. Everyone is doing this at the moment here.
Mm.
We're talking about the systemic change, but who is actually going to make these changes? So we need some strategic urban governance. It's very different. People are watching from all over the world.
Mm.
It's very, very different if you're sitting in Singapore or Chicago of how to do this this governance. The systems are very different.
Yeah.
But everywhere there's making big decisions in every boardroom. So that's the thing. I think it's politics, but it's also actions.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of it also just comes down to the process and the culture. Are we allowed to fail? And are we really making sure that acting is, you know, you can have a strategy, but the strategy shouldn't be on top. Your action should be on top.
Yes.
And the strategy is simply an enabler that kind of helps the actions, but the action should be your guiding star. But that's a lot easier said than done. I was talking to the leading public servant who was facilitating a new build within the waste sector recently, and I was saying, well, guys, like, you're here now and you're just starting up. If you're going to be finished in 5 years and you haven't failed, then you haven't been ambitious enough in terms of
exactly
what you do, which is easy for me to say, and I believe that it's right, but I also get from him being a public servant that, you know, it's going to be very difficult.
You can feel the tremor.
Political systems.
Yeah.
Well, I fail, but I have to fail.
Yeah.
So we need, from a cultural perspective, to be much better at allowing that.
Yeah. And I think as part of, I think that was an alarm reminding me that I should start wrapping up. But I think it's a very, very good. I think it's a very good point, and it also ties into going back to Signe in terms of that we need to stop the top, where we don't see the consequences of our actions till 5 years or
10 years, and we don't innovate just to innovate, but we do trial and error.
We do develop while we're designing. That greater good. That was, we got a cue. That basically means that it's time that I say a huge thank you to you, Ditte, and you, Nikolaj. It was such a pleasure having this conversation with you. And to you out watching us, you will now be sent into your breakout sessions, and I will see you at 11. And I hope you have a fruitful and brilliant discussion with your peers. Have a good time. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Welcome back. I hope you've had a great breakout session. And I know some of you have been writing to Tobias to get transferred. And on that note, my sincere apologies for the disturbing lack of sound during our first session of today's program. We apologize sincerely, and we will try and see if we can do some magic in the recorded version that we will publish, hopefully very, very soon. So again, apologies. We've been working on these sound issues during the break. So if some of you are still find that I'm not going coming through clearly to you, please write it in the chat, because then we'll have a look at it again. It's important to us that you can actually hear what's going on, because we're really, really happy that you're here. So apologies again. We're now arriving at the session where we actually have Q&A. And on that note, some of you have listed and written some brilliant comments and questions in the session with Signe Kongebro from Henning Larsen. And we have arranged with Signe that your questions will actually be addressed with Henning Larsen afterwards. So in our follow-up, the mail that you'll receive from us after this event, we will also have the answers to you regarding the questions that some of you listed to Signe during that session. And as well, we've also spoken to Nikolaj and Ditte, and they will also, if you have any concrete questions to them, give their 2 cents worth in a follow-up. So everything should be okay in terms of questions and answers to those sessions earlier on today. And again, we apologize that the sound was bugging some of you participating. It really not how we wanted it. But let's see if we can't pick it up. So you have had 5 breakout sessions, and some of you have been engaged lively in debates. So if I could call on some of my wonderful colleagues, Martine, for example, could I ask you to turn on your camera and maybe give us a quick rundown of what you discussed at your breakout session?
Of course, Pernille, can you hear me?
And now I'm looking, I can actually see Martine.
Can you hear me as well?
We can hear you here on Zoom, but I think that Pernille cannot hear you. We are getting that fixed just a second.
Okay, so if I just start talking, Pernille, I hope you get the sound from somewhere else. But thank you so much for the word and for the interesting discussions that we were just able to have now. Yes, indeed, we were looking at the urban mobility challenges that we have across borders from many different perspectives, actually. We saw it from Sweden, from India, from Israel, from Denmark, from many different angles. And what is interesting is discuss how we actually define mobility. And we were talking about this actually has really no borders in order to define. Is it how we transport ourselves? Is it how we have access to activities and the other functions? And what are the challenges at the different markets? And this is, of course, very interesting, but what we are all looking into is that changes are being made, but it's a bit slow and it's hard to have solutions from one market fit other markets directly. And of course, we all know this, but mm-hmm. we can really learn from each other. So I think there was a very... very big agreement on that sharing these experiences that we have gives high value to actually taking the next steps into the implementation as well. So we shared a few ideas of solutions, both for accommodating the public transportation a little bit more, but also seeing mobility issues from an angle from Bangalore in India, where they have 12 million people. The challenges here are a bit different than, for example, in Copenhagen. So always a pleasure. And Lasse, who joined my session from the Innovation Center, invited companies to come and see them in Israel to collaborate on actually finding solutions on mobility. So we are sure in the good process of connecting dots here.
That sounds absolutely wonderful. And I was also inspired by Signe Kongebro's, where she said that they are now conducting research on taxonomy of mobility. I don't know if you had a chance to address that in your breakout session as well.
Sorry, now the sound was a bit bad from your side to me.
could you hear me, Martine?
Yes.
Okay.
But please repeat.
All right, sorry. I was just thinking that Signe Kongebro, when she talked about the taxonomy of mobility, the study that they are currently doing in terms of like the pyramid of materials, whether you also talked about these different types of mobilities inspired by Signe?
Yeah, you know, it's all types of mobility is very much also inspired by the way that Yaya Architects, one of our members, is working with mobility as not being the food pyramid that we have, but actually a mobility pyramid, and to combine these different solutions where you have different solutions for different both distances, but of course also situations. Mm. And they actually showed a great example of this from the Swedish side, where they have a little booklet that you could simply just turn to page 2, where it said 2 kilometers, and you would look into the booklet and say, okay, what kind of mobility is optimal for this distance in this situation, and so on. So it is very much on combining the different solutions and not necessarily just picking a few.
Mm. And I would also, just following up on that, I would also assume that when you talk about sharing knowledge, that there's just not one size fits all. Did you also relay or debate how to share those various pieces of experiences and knowledges so that we can, in unison, become more informed and adept at changing the solutions to the given situation?
Yes, we talked about different ways of doing this as very concrete ideas. You know, I mentioned the one with the delegation coming from companies and initiators to new markets to see what will actually fit into this situation. But also I explained a little bit on the way we do this in BLOXHUB, where we simply need to increase this level of knowledge by combining the different sectors that look into a certain challenge. So it's extremely important that we look at the challenge from different angles. So to increase the level of knowledge, it's has very much to do with also tearing down these borders that you not only look at mobility from tech experts or what we are calling mobility experts, but also from the behavioral side, from the city side, from stakeholder involvement, from all kinds of sectors or stakeholders within this area. So a way of doing this is by innovation processes, but also simply by talking with each other as we do today.
I completely agree. And if there are any of you from the other breakout sessions that have comments or questions to this particular topic, please feel free to write them in the chat, and then I'll be informed of those questions so I can call upon Martina again. Thank you so very, very much, Martina, for sharing with us what you had in your breakout sessions. It was really nice to hear from you. So, and I now know my colleagues that they'll be sitting there going, don't call on me, Pernille, but I will. So my dear colleague, Torben Krapp, I would love to hear what you discussed in your breakout sessions on livable cities.
Thanks, Pernille. well, we had a quite interesting discussion about, of course, the complexity of actually having these words like livability and healthy cities being put into a framework that actually has an impact-driven process to it, and not just some buzzwords floating around in some overall levels. And we, more specifically, we talked about Shanghai and Bangalore. And what was interesting was, of course, the classical discussion then that the context is quite defining in where to start this discussion. In Shanghai, there is a strong understanding from a citizen's perspective of convenience in when it comes to livability. But as Enlai also from Smith-Hammer-Lassen noted, was that when we talk about these things, we also need to understand livability from not just a consumer perspective, but also a producing kind of perspective, because we need to see the city as an ecosystem on its own. With a higher consuming also leads to a higher producing need. And we need to get that very center in the way that we discuss things. And of course, then moving to Bangalore, where it was not so much an initial discussion about convenience, but more a question about some basic needs when it comes to pollution, and how you should work with these this value-based approach in its early stage of a designing process in urban development, where you both need the classical combination of the top-down, but also the bottom-up approach in order to create a meaningful impact-driven agenda for these concepts. And then we actually ended up, and we unfortunately did not have time to fully diving into that specific case of a Nanjing case about a renovating part of the city where you actually put in a value-based approach of continuing the historical meaning of this area and values. And but I hope that we in BLOXHUB can actually work with this challenge at a later stage where we can take a further deep dive into this. So I've written to you, Mr. Howe, and I hope we can continue the dialogue after this session of today.
Oh, that sounds absolutely beautiful, Torben. And because I also think that some of the things that that you have addressed were similar to Signe Kongebro in terms of releasing the potential, remember the history and the culture, and with curiosity, try and then identify new ways. And although the sound from Ditte and Nikolaj may have been a little bit poor, I would also assume, or I'm asking, did you think of the regenerative city discussion, some of the recommendations from Ditte and Nikolaj when we are redesigning the cities?
Unfortunately, we did not, the whole redesigning discussion, we did not get into a very detailed discussion about that. So unfortunately not, but I hope again that that is something that we can take up at a later roundtable in BLOXHUB, maybe based on the specific case we had from Nanjing.
Yeah. And I don't know if Mr. Howe, you would like to present the Nanjing, or Thomas Trøst Hansen, if one, because it sounds as if it is a perfect example to share, given what we've been discussing earlier with Ditte and Nikolaj. So now I'm just looking to Tobias. Should we call on Thomas Trøst Hansen?
Sure, let's ask Thomas.
Thank you very much. I think what is really interesting about this Nanjing case is the fact that we have an area in the city center that has been in need of renovation and development, and we've actually seen a very sensitive approach to it. But there was a beautiful movie made for it. Is it possible to show that one, or is that what you're thinking? Or
that was six. You could read my mind, Thomas. I'm just going to look down at Tobias. Is that possible if Thomas does this?
Sorry, we just need to have that again. Thomas, what were you asking for?
To show a video.
Sure.
Well, could I ask Torben to do it? Because I think he has it ready on his computer, and I don't have it on this computer. But I'm...
Yeah, I will share my screen now. I think I'm allowed. Pernille, can you just confirm that now there is a video that is not playing right now, but up on your screen? Okay, then let's go.
小西湖历史风貌区的保护与再生的一些情况。小西湖历史风貌区改造项目位于我们青川区老城南的核心区域，占地面积由4.69万平方米，现状建筑面积5.08万平方米。 留存了有七条历史街巷，两处五保单位，七处历史建筑和三十余处的传统院落，是南京为数不多的比较完整保留零星风貌特征的居住型的街区之一，也是南京市二十二片历史风貌区之一，承载着深厚的南京记忆。散发着浓郁的烟火气息，小西湖片区同时也是一个老旧的古朴区，基础设施老旧，居民生活条件落后，这与飞速发展的现代化城市显得那么的格格不入。如何改善片区居民的生活条件，提升他们的生活品质，同时又能够保留下优秀的历史文化以及民族文化，能够留下记忆和乡愁，让这个片区重新焕发它的生机和活力。 这是需要我们创新探索和治理解决的一个问题。2015年，我们开始进行项目的政策研究；2017年，项目启动了搬迁；2019年，开始实施微更新的改造；2021年，我们的改造成果已经初步呈现。在整个的改造过程中，我们通过了共商、共建、共享、共赢的这个理念。 实施了小尺度渐进式的微更新的改造模式，按照一院一策的方法开展更新，将老城保护与改善民生共荣共促。我们保留了片区内原有的明清建筑风貌和官员曲折的街巷肌理，让历史文化得以感知和延续，在全国首创了历史风貌区微型的综合馆的建设。 完善和强大了片区的基础设施功能。我们打造了和谐共处的共生院落，让社区规划师和原住民共处在同一院落，共做好邻居。我们还打造了共享院落，让居民打开自家院门，和邻居游客共同享受院子的美丽风景。我们精心设计了平移安置房，解决了部分居民生活困难、互土难移的这种困境。 与此同时，街区还引入了一些新的业态，如西湖里咖啡、灯彩博物馆、崇文馆、欢乐茶馆、24小时的书屋，以及花间堂的精品民宿。新鲜的业态和老建筑的碰撞交融，使更多的年轻人都涌入了这个街区，让整个街区充满了活力。改造后的小西湖。 气质和颜值与百姓的幸福指数同步提升，成为市民游客热衷的网红打卡地，受到中央、省市各级媒体的关注和报道，被誉为老城改造的美丽样板，同时被评为全国十大优秀更新案例。小西湖微更新的改造，它的价值在于探索出了老城保护明确可操作的新的路径和方法。 小西湖的保护与再生，也是一场没有终极的实践。希望我的分享能给大家在重塑绿色城市方面带来一些帮助，同时也希望以后能有更多的机会可以加强国际间的彼此交流，分享成功的经验，共同推动城市更新建设，让我们的城市变得越来越美好。谢谢大家。
Thank you very, 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 very much, Thomas. I don't know if you want to comment on it. I think it really exemplifies just what this entire day is about.
Well, the only comment I would like to give is that this is actually a collaboration which is founded upon a partnership between BLOXHUB and Tush Park Jiangsu. Our partner from Tush Park is with us here in the audience, Mr. Hao, and I think it is an MOU was signed between BLOXHUB and Tush Park a few months ago, and we would like to see more Danish companies working on some of these cases that Tush Park wants to bring to the table. So stay tuned; there'll be more coming on this.
Thank you very much, Thomas. And I have actually had the pleasure a few years ago to visit Nanjing, so I can testify that this is a really, really beautiful renovation. So thank you. It sounds as if you've had a really, really productive breakout session. I'm now going to move us to the circular construction, and my dear colleague Jakob Norman, I know that you were challenged because you were actually without your wingman, as he had some internet difficulties in Seoul. So Jakob, what have you been working on in your breakout session?
Yes, thank you, Pernille. Yes, it was a shame. I was hoping to hear a lot of interesting perspectives from Peter from Seoul. But sometimes the internet does not want what we want, so we have to improvise a little bit. But we had a very good discussion in any case. I started. You can all hear me, right? Okay.
Sorry to disturb you. We just want your picture through. What was your name again? Sorry.
Jakob.
Yes. Sorry, Jakob. Just a second. Jakob Norman Hansen.
So, but I can continue speaking. So I started by explaining also why circular construction and circular economy is such an important topic for BLOXHUB. In this spirit, it's a very integral part of our strategy, and we really have a lot of interest from our members that we are also working on this project with other organizations. Like the Confederation of Danish Industries, about creating the irresistible circular society. So that was kind of the framework for the discussions. We were discussing about a circular economy and circular construction in terms of a kind of a big cargo ship that needs to be to change course. And as we know, it can take a lot of time for big organizations and big sectors like the building industry to change course. So I think we all agree that something has to be done, like we heard in the discussions in the beginning. But how do we do it in Denmark, and how do we do it in Asia? So that was kind of the nexus of the discussions. We talked a lot about the need for constant focus on research and innovation. I think that's something we look at on both continents. And I also explained that you, Pernille, are managing a group of PhDs or industry PhDs working with some member companies up on specific topics like developing the right business models, developing technical solutions like more sustainable concrete. And I think that's one very big part of the solution. But also we discussed how we accelerate this transition, and in order to accelerate that, we need to get everyone on board. We need the population to get on board, and this is something we can do, I think, by this project on creating the irresistible circular society. So circular solutions also in the building sector become more easy. It becomes the obvious choice and not something that's forced upon people. I think we have some interesting solutions or perspectives on that from the Nordic countries. But we also need the investors on board. We need the decision makers. And that is kind of the trick, because the investment horizon within the built environment is quite long. So you make investments for 30 years down the line. And if you have someone proposing you a circular business model that may be risky, you can be, or investors can be hesitant to take up that challenge. So we discussed what to do about that. And I think also here we need the pressure to come from all sides, also come from the users. One very interesting perspective that we need to strengthen the link between the users and the investors. Usually you have a lot of stations between those two. We also discussed the differences between Asia and the Nordics. And I think the perspective was that then in Asia, we need, there's also a lot of talk about circular construction and circular economy, but maybe more talk than actually identifiable solutions. I mentioned that we recently, together with some other organizations, also created Denmark and Danish Design Center, have made a white paper that actually takes some of these solutions and some of these projects as a starting point for the discussions at least about how to get there. I can just show you the link here. So we need more examples. We need also leaders to create these examples, and in Asia maybe to, for example, work in high end construction to make sustainable building projects, and that will kind of trickle down maybe to other constructions as well. But it is a challenge to do this quickly, because for example, on cement, if you need to prove that sustainable cement is more, is just as good as regular cement, maybe you need 4 or 5 years to do that. So it is a challenge, and we need to come up with these good examples all the time.
I think it's absolutely brilliant. And as you say, Jakob, we need to share the solutions. We know from Ditte, who was here earlier, that Lendager, they're actually working with reusing existing cement and concrete to kind of show that it can be done instead of producing new. So, and also make sure that it is just as good and viable aesthetically as when it was used the first time. So I think that is I think that's a very good point. I also, in case that this is where there was poor quality of sound, I think Ditte had a very good point when she said to look for the objectives of investment when we're building a building. As she said, formerly that was because it was required, it was seen as an answer for the city for development. Today we have investment in building construction for the investment alone. Maybe we need to change the objectives ever so slightly. And as Thomas Lutzendorf from Karlsruhe Institute of Technology has identified, there is actually an increasing demand from the financial sector to ask for these sustainable investments. So I think it sounds as if you've had a really, really good discussion in your breakout session. And when you mentioned the industrial researchers, I can say that Thomas Trost, who was in the other breakout session, and I have been working quite hard on ensuring that these researchers will actually be able to mediate and present their research, and that will take place in Seoul next year in 2022, to make sure that we can engage in that dialogue, as Signe Kongebro also emphasized was so important in terms of the partnerships. So maybe in your session, there were also the initial talks to engage in what we heard Torben Krabb would kind of see as a challenge, as an endeavor to collaborate in providing some solutions together. So thank you very, very much, Jakob, for that. It was really nice to hear from your breakout session. I'll move swiftly to design cities and call on Helle Steendorf.
Pernille, before we move on, I just want to check with you. Do we have time for someone asking a question?
Yes.
We just have in line. Do you want to come through with a question? Just put your hand up again.
Time.
Sorry?
Only if there's time.
There is time.
No, I just wanted to sort of connect the dots between what Jakob was talking about, and perhaps there was a comment by Torben on Thomas's presentation in China. And that is, we talked a lot about in the cities group about scalability or how you scale. And it's a very political a question, and Pernille herself was talking about how you invest. And there's something very positive about the example that we saw in China, because it's based on something that we care about a lot in Svenhammarlassen, which is adaptive transformation, and how you allow you reduce the risk profile, and how you allow the economics of the situation to permit this kind of transformation to happen, which is sensitive, with, you know, micro infrastructures, etc. Because when you do that kind of micro infrastructural development, you actually open up the market for a lot of small players, a lot of renovators, a lot of people who are local and on the ground in that community to be in engaged in the economy of the transformation, which is significant. And it also means that you have an infinite amount of flexibility when you come to scale it across a country or across the international sphere. Mm. That the beauty of that is that it can flex to context. And what China has done, what Denmark is somewhat doing as well in many cases, or has done, and Signe has spoken about that as well, is the rollout of centrally almost industrialized systems of building and infrastructure that do not, it's not only that they don't, they break up local social structures in the spaces that they replace, but it also concentrates the resources, the power, let's say the waste into very centralized companies that have a lot of political power. But what they neglect is the incredible value of the local economy investing in itself. And that's what can happen with these micro infrastructures.
I think it's absolutely, I agree, and I think it's a wonderful comment to kind of try and tie the knot between the different themes. And I also think it's a beautiful introduction to the breakout session on designing cities. So calling on Helle again to hear what you had going on in your breakout session.
Yes, thank you, Pernille. Well, in our breakout session, we had a great group of people from different places. Mi Hong Kim from South Korea, from the Innovation Center Denmark in South Korea, was mentioning one of the biggest challenges there is the hierarchical approach compared to the Danish model. You might say, and we had some people from India who were agreeing very much on that that challenge, and amongst others, we had someone mentioning that that the challenge is that cities are already very much established, and that waste management is a big problem. Mm. So focus is more on technology and mobility than the actual facilitation of designing the cities.
Well, that's interesting.
Yeah. So, but then again, in the end, we I think it was the Danish embassy in India who also mentioned, well, one does not leave out the other. So. Designing for technology and mobility is also interconnected. Mm. But again, there's not a one size fits all. It's a lot about which city, which culture, and the governance we are working within. Yeah. And then in the last couple of minutes, we came around one other challenge, which was to attract and keep students. So, deciding for students and also with the question, what do we actually need? Can we break it down to the minimal needs and can we facilitate this more? Mm. In the search for designing cities for students. Yeah.
Well, that's interesting.
Some of
our colleagues have been collaborating with Circular City New York on that challenge with Barnard College. So that is it's nice to hear that is also a challenge elsewhere in the world. That is absolutely brilliant. Thank you. I don't know, Mihan Kim, if you want to comment on what Helle has said in terms of did you find any kind of concrete next steps or anything? Feel free to add.
First of all, I was really impressed with what BLOXHUB is doing in Copenhagen city. And this kind of hub, they can provide a lot of solutions and make a good connection with the startups and the SMEs. It's a fantastic hub. It's really important to have the kind of organization. In Korea, we don't really have this kind of organization at this moment. So perhaps it would be really nice to try to make these BLOXHUB systems in Korea to make the better network with the cities and then other architect companies and other startups who has the urban solutions. So
that sounds wonderful. I know for sure that we would love to share and connect and even identify a project for collaboration inspired by Signe. Go with your gut and identify the right partners, and then develop as you design, so we can see if we could come up with some concrete solutions in terms of designing cities for students. Thank you very, very much, Mihang and Helle. It sounds again as if it's actually been a really, really interesting breakout session. Calling on Lotte. Lotte, I assume you were smiling when you heard the conversation addressing students in cities, because this is something that is very close to your heart and what you've been collaborating with Bernard College. However, and you are obviously allowed to comment on that, but last but not least, you and Martin Hoxha from Shanghai, you've been looking at how will we finance this lovely transition of reinventing our cities. And how was your breakout session?
Okay, Lotte, we don't have sound on you. You have to unmute your mic. There you go. Thank you.
Thank you, Pernille. We also had a great breakout session in my group. We didn't talk only about business model and financing. And I think that the reason for that is when you have to create a business model, you have all these different kind of different elements into the model. So I think some of the things we discussed has been set or has been discussed in the other groups as well. But this thing about that there is the need for sustainable solutions is global, but the challenges are different. So back to this, there is no one size fits all. We had I'm not sure if I pronounce his name correct, but we had Prasanth from Bangalore talking about how Bangalore have had an explosive growth over the past 20 years and how to cope with that with sustainable solutions. And that's a total different challenge that we have in Denmark, for instance. So this talking about there is no one size fits all. The overall need is the same, but we need to look at different solutions for each culture, each society, each country. But the need for collaboration and a holistic view is also, we all agreed that was, you know, that was needed. And we talked about We had the workshop, working with students from Bernard, and how can we involve them in developing and spreading the circular solutions. But we also talked about briefly about another workshop we had, talking about how can we look at our values in a different way in order to make investors invest maybe before the land or the city or the area is attractive? How can we actually develop something that investors will invest in before the area is developed, and how to make sure that that solutions we implement are based on long-term view. But we also had some comments from some of the participants that the products are actually there. So back to Ditte's comment on no more talking. Now we just need to do the action. We also talked about the green solution products are there. So now we just need to export it. Now we just need to, you know, get it out to be used. And then we had Simon from the NIS project. NIS is Nordic Innovation Sustainable Campus in Shanghai. He talked about that project. And Martin, would it be an idea just to say in this broader audience, to say a few words about the upcoming workshop? Do you want to promote it with a few words?
Yes, thank you a lot, and thank you, Simon, also for presenting the NIS project. I think it's very ambitious. And I think what the NIS project is focusing on is basically to embark on the very ambitious green transition goals set here in China. I think the biggest impact that Denmark can have on the world is basically to export innovative solutions when it comes to clean tech and so on into China, because the emission coming out of China is 26%. So we really need to work with our Chinese stakeholders here. The workshop on October 20th will specifically look at how to engage into this project and how that can be a landing path for Danish companies that wants to enter into China. And my few sort of experience on that part, being here in Shanghai, has basically been to identify projects that can accelerate Danish companies into the market. And I'm super happy and excited that we'll be able to present this project on our joint workshop with BLOXHUB on October 20th.
Wonderful. Thank you so very much. Brilliant accounts of what have been what went on in the various breakout sessions. And I'm just looking, have we got any questions?
Not right now, but I would just tell everyone to state a question now if you have one, right?
Because we are coming to that part of the day where I have the honor of wrapping up, as it were. And if you've been wondering why I sometimes turn my head, it's because the people talking have been on the screen to my left. And it is only a natural response that you want to look people in the eye and say how nice it is to see you. So when I've been looking away, I apologize. It's actually because I've been so happy to see Thomas and Martin and Mihong and Jakob and Torben and Lotte and Hilla and Martina. And thank you so much for your wonderful contributions and accounts, so that we've all now been participating in 5 breakout sessions. It is invaluable to have this amount of knowledge sharing on a day like today. So some of the things that come into my mind is basically the word that Signe finished her presentation with. She had on her slide curiosity. And even we are globally facing what may seem as daunting challenges that we have to solve within a very, very short matter of time. It is only by being curious to each other's solutions and insights and objectives that we can actually solve them. And I think Ditte and Nikolaj also advocated that. Come together, we may not be wanting to go to Mars, but if our moon is just planet Earth that needs saving, we will be able to do it together. And I thank you for tying a beautiful knot between the some of the breakout sessions, because it is exactly necessary that we think of scale, but also the local context. Again, quoting Signe Kongebro, it's the hyper-local, and we need to have an intuitive understanding, an emotional understanding of the various contexts when we embark on our collaborations and our partnerships. Today was the first step where we are reaching out to you from various continents that we would like to collaborate. We would like to engage in these partnerships to come together and find the right solution to reinventing our cities, ensuring the green transition. I know that Ida has been sharing a link in the chat or is about to do so. This is not just any typical evaluation link. This is actually a link where you can answer who you would like to be in contact with. Who do you want us to reach out to on your behalf? Because the setup of today is to, this was the initial step, the first step of getting to know each other from afar, combined virtually in space, as it were. However, we don't stop here. We want to identify how we can continue the dialogue, how we can continue addressing the challenges that need solving, and maybe we are the right partners to do so. So in the link, please write if you would like us to reach out to someone else on your behalf so we can set up those next steps of meetings, because it's in those meetings where we can take it to the solution mode. Go from talking to action. Quoting Ditte, strategize, but action should be on top of our strategy. So that's what we are encouraging us all to do today, is to reach out to each other in order to enact on what we have heard today. We have been inspired, hopefully, by the interesting speakers. We've discussed the topics in our various groups. We're far from done. The journey of inspiration and collaboration continues, just as I have said. So let us spend a few minutes, this is the chat, the link, to reflect and take the next steps towards interesting new potentials. We will also be back in a new summit next year, because we think that the partnerships and collaborations that we are embarking on today deserve a follow-up. And we deserve to continuously exchange and share and discuss and identify just where we want to go from here in reinventing our cities, making that green transition for everyone around the world, not just for the chosen few. My name is Pernille. On behalf of Innovation Center Denmark, innovation centers across the world, on behalf of my wonderful and brilliant colleagues from BLOXHUB, I wish you a very, very good day, and thank you for participating. Bye for now.